Christ is risen. Thank you. I wasn't sure if we knew that well enough that you'd follow me, but great. One of the things that's really blessed me this last two months, I guess it's been, we've been on this journey of Lent to the cross. And the monologues, every week we've had a visit from somebody from the New Testament. And I don't know, something in me this year, it just made the story more real. Real people were there. Real people were feeling the depth of emotion that goes with this story. And if I'm honest, most Easter Sundays, I'm just glad to get there. This year, I'm still stuck back a couple weeks ago. And God's still working in my spirit. You know, I don't like the suffering and pain, the darkness of Jesus as he moves towards the cross. And so I want to rush ahead. Let's get to resurrection. Because, yeah, that's wonderful and glorious. But I don't like living with the pain of it, the unanswered questions, and the monologues that we have heard have allowed us to ask questions this year. And this morning, thank you, Margaret, for Mary Magdalene. It just really brings the story to life for me. I have a song that I want to play. It's a Soil and Seed Project song. Some of you are familiar with that. Others of you have probably never heard of that. Seth Christman, most of you know, is the producer of that project. And they put out an Easter album this year. And what they do is they bring in all kinds of musicians from all over the place. So it's not just Seth and his group, but it's other groups. And this is a song that Valeria and Taylor Bess have written and performed for this CD. And I'm going to play it, and it's called They Have Taken Him. So, Bob, let's see if we've got the connection and the sound.
While the garden lay sleeping, feel the dew upon my head, cool from the weeping of the stone. The night still clings heavy like a shroud. I whisper to the emptiness, and the echo is as loud as thunder. It's a wonder the dead slumber. I do not know where he's gone. Then all the world's in motion, running like the waves, trying to outrun the ocean. And they overtake each other, brother tumbling over brother, to the threshold but daring not go in. Sparrows winging up. gardener is keeping watch over the morning ones. He'll watch until the morning comes aflame. And sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you laid him so I may go to him today. Oh, his silence breaks my spirit, and so soft I barely hear it. He remakes me with a whisper of my name. They have not taken him. I have seen the coming dawn. I know they have not taken him. I know I've seen the coming.
I can relate. There's moments in my life where I'm going, God, where are you? And then he shows up. He shows up. He's risen. He's active in our lives, even at times when we don't have a clue what's going on. When all is darkness, seems dark, you know, our lives don't make sense. Friday, we had a Good Friday service and we left the building in darkness. We had focused on the suffering and death. Jesus alone, betrayed, deserted, accused, condemned and crucified. His followers confused, sad, some unable to even watch. And they left in fear. Others unable to take their eyes off of him. Despite what they were seeing, and yet still so confused. It didn't make sense. Despair, grief, and darkness. This morning I want to focus on the things that happened as Jesus died. And it may seem a bit weird for a Resurrection Sunday, but I hope it becomes clear as we move forward. Darkness. If you've been following the news, in a week, a little more than a week, we're going to have an eclipse. I don't know. Maybe it's not eclipse. Eclipse. Well, however you pronounce it. And I remember a couple years ago, or several years ago, there was one. And I was impressed with how dark it got as the moon covered the sun, and we were left there in the middle of the day. But what happened when Jesus was on the cross was not an eclipse. They last about 4 to 7 minutes, and this was 3 hours of darkness. Not only the darkness, but an earthquake. Rocks split open and the tombs opened up, and some people were raised from the dead. But the event that this morning I want to focus on is this curtain. The temple curtain, torn in two, starting from the top, going down to the bottom. Remember that crucifixions were common in that day. They think thousands of people were killed on the cross. The Jews and the Romans alike knew what to anticipate when someone was crucified. But what happened when Jesus was crucified? Everyone knew that this was an extraordinary crucifixion. Something was different. And I find it ironic that it was the Romans who seemed to be the most impacted by it. They knew it was a special death. Verses 54, Matthew 27, 54. When the centurion and those with him who were guarding Jesus saw the earthquake and all that had happened, they were terrified and exclaimed, "Surely he was the Son of God." Only verses before, the Jews were mocking Jesus. Verse 39, those who passed by hurled insults at him, shaking their head. "You who were going to destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, save yourself. Come down from the cross if you are the Son of God." In the same way, the chief priests, the teachers of the law, and elders mocked him. "He saved others," they said, "but he can't save himself. He's the King of Israel. Let him come down now from the cross, and we will believe in him." I find it ironic. The Jews were mocking him. The people Jesus had come to live among were the ones mocking him. And it was the Romans, the Gentiles, that were acknowledging, "This is the Son of God." But maybe, what would we expect from the Jews? For almost all their life, the presence of God was where? It was in the Holy of Holies, in the temple, in this 15 by 15 room, where the Ark of the Covenant was kept. And so when Israel wanted to move from place to place, the Ark of the Covenant went out in front of them. It was the presence of God leading them. And Vicki, I think there's a picture of an imitation ark. It's not the real one, and it may have some flaws in it. I don't know how authentic it is. But you can see the ark covered with gold, and there were two cherubim sitting on top of it. And inside, it contained the Ten Commandments, the stones that Moses had carved them on, the tablets. There was a jar of manna that the children of Israel had collected. And Aaron's rod was in that Ark of the Covenant. The wood bars on the side were the only things you could touch. It was the way they carried it. And they would put it on a cart, lift it onto a cart with those bars. If you touched the Ark of the Covenant itself, you would die. And so the Ark went ahead of them. And that's, let's go to the next slide before I'm moving forward. Okay, I can't see because my screen back there is not on. Sorry. This is the temple. And you can see this is only the part where the priests would work. And they could go in that first part. But then you see, I think it's on the top, you see kind of a square room with a curtain in front of it. That's the curtain they believed was split wide open. And that curtain is so important to this story because with the tearing of that curtain, it changed the entire way that God was going to relate to humanity. So it's understandable that many Jews, they didn't understand what it was to be in the presence of God. Most of them had always expected the prophets, the priests, and a few leaders to speak to God for them. Well, there's two times in the Bible when that didn't happen. The first one was in the Garden of Eden, when God walked with Adam and Eve. There was communion, face to face with God. Well, it happens again in the New Testament, and sometimes we fail to realize that. God's presence walked with the disciples, with the women, with those that he healed, whose lives were transformed because they had a direct connection to God. And those that had this connection with God are the ones that were so deeply disturbed and concerned about what was happening with Jesus. They loved Jesus. They understood a certain part of who Jesus was. And Vicki, you can take that down. Excuse me. Mary Magdalene, for example, didn't know a God who lived behind a temple curtain. She knew Jesus was the Son of God. It was Jesus that had set her free when no one else could. She had watched what happened on the cross. She saw Jesus die. She saw Jesus laid in the tomb. She stuck with him. Mourners in those days would take spices to the tomb. It was a symbol of their love and devotion to the loved one that had passed. And so Nicodemus and Joseph had put spices on the body when they buried him in the tomb. But the women that morning also wanted to express their love and devotion. So they came that morning to the tomb with their spices. The body was gone. They didn't understand why. Even though Jesus had told them, "In 3 days I will rise," it didn't connect. It didn't make sense. People don't rise from the dead. And so the only option was somebody took the body. Where did they put him? How can we express our love and devotion? And so she meets the gardener. In the song, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you laid him so I may go to him today." The words continue, "Oh, his silence breaks my spirit, and so soft I barely hear it. He remakes me with the whisper of my name." They have not taken him. I've seen the coming dawn. I know they have not taken him. I know I've seen the coming of the dawn. When the curtain was torn in two, the barrier between God and us was removed. Everyone could now come freely to God. It changed the entire way God related to us. The amazing change that happened was the dwelling place of God. God no longer dwelt in the holy place. God dwells in us. What does it mean for God to dwell in us. Now, I may be jumping ahead of the story because he dwells in us because of the Holy Spirit, which we have another 50 days to wait for that story. But this curtain tearing was the indication that something was changing. And you are the dwelling place of God. What does that mean? It changes how we live. It means we're no longer reflecting just ourselves. We're reflecting the God who lives in us. Of course, if God doesn't live in us, there's no way that we can reflect that God. But God's desire is to live in us. 1 Corinthians 3:15 to 16 says, "Don't you know that you yourselves are God's temple and that God's Spirit dwells in your midst? If anyone destroys God's temple, God will destroy that person. For God's temple is sacred, and you together are that temple." You together are that temple. So, that means there's a part of God that's not in me that I need to recognize. And that's the part of God that's in each of you. Community. That means that when I think about God, it's not only what I think about God in me. It requires me to listen to what God is saying to you. That I don't have the full information about who God is. Drew Dick is a book I read. He Yawning at Tigers. It's a book, he quotes, "It seems that God was making it abundantly clear that Jesus' death changed everything. Rather than restrict his presence to a building, God had opened a way whereby everyone could come freely to him." What a beautiful gesture of love. Jesus entered the Holy of Holies as both high priest and sacrifice, so that we could have intimacy with the Father. This intimacy didn't come cheap. It was purchased with divine blood. When the curtain was torn, the dwelling place in the temple, in the building, was destroyed. You are now the dwelling place of God. God lives with you. He walks with you. And he is reflected in who you are and what you do. That's why we say imperfect people reflecting God's love. And sadly, we can contemplate the cross. We can hear Christ's final cry of anguish. We can see the temple curtain torn. And yet, we can walk away unchanged. We can pray. We can read the Bible. We can memorize it front to back. And still walk away unchanged. We need to experience God, the God who lives in us. There's a Greek word, koinonia. Koinonia. I'm not an expert on it, but it talks about the communion, the relationship, the time we spend with God. It's even broader than that. It talks about the communion and the relationship that we spend together with other brothers and sisters in Christ. Do you believe God loves you? Do you believe God has forgiven you? When you have experienced a loving God, when you have had communion with God, He remakes you with a whisper of your name. That is the good news of the gospel. That is why we celebrate Easter, a time of new hope and new beginnings, as we reassure ourselves of the risen Christ. My hope and my prayer for us is that you don't let Easter go by without absorbing into your life the true message of Easter. The message of a risen Christ who dwells in you. Excuse me. If you want to know more about that, this weekend, Sight and Sound is sharing the story of Jesus for free. If you download the Sight and Sound app, don't pay the subscription unless you want to, but you don't have to. You just click on Jesus, the movie, and you see Sight and Sound's version. It'll bring joy to your life. Something you can do this afternoon. This morning, Christ is present here with us. And we're going to share the Lord's Supper together. And we're going to do it gathering around the tables in groups. As we reflect that communion isn't only an experience we have with God, it's an experience we also have with each other. We gather united. We gather with a spirit of teamwork and cooperation as we seek to understand what does it mean that Christ dwells in us. We worship, we pray, we grow and mature together. We encourage and support one another. And we are on mission today, together. This morning we celebrate the Lord's Supper together. We remember what Jesus has done. We share in this act of communion, this act of renewal with Christ and with each other. I invite the deacons who are going to lead us to find their position, and we'll give instructions. So those who are coming up to the table, I have a prayer yet, but let's get set up. What we'll do is you will come forward in groups of six, and I'll be back there to kind of help let you know. We're going to start in the front, we'll start with you'll just kind of file towards the center and come up and gather around the table in groups of six. So let's begin the communion service. What a magnificent supper this is. This is not ordinary eating and drinking. For the dinner host is God. The one who presides is Christ. All believers are his guest, and the food is the power of the flesh and spilt blood of Jesus. Who is suitable to partake? Those who have a hearty faith in the love of God and the Word. Those who are filled with remorse for their sins and trust in their hearts that God forgives sinners for Christ's sake. Those who live in purity for God, heeding the voice of our shepherd, Jesus Christ. Therefore, let there be no sorrow, no hesitance about coming to the table of the Lord. For there we receive the forgiveness of our sins and the promise of eternal life. Blessed are you, God of heaven and earth. In mercy for our fallen world, you gave your only Son, that all those who believe in him should not perish, but have eternal life. We give thanks to you for the salvation you have prepared for us through Jesus Christ. Send now your Holy Spirit into your hearts, into our hearts, that we may receive our Lord with a living faith as he comes to us in his Holy Supper. Let's pray the Lord's Prayer together using trespasses. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we also forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
The song of response we're doing this morning, I love that some of the contemporary Christian songs, how they're resurrecting these old songs. This is a song that was written in the early 1900s by a Presbyterian minister from Georgia named John Wilbur Chapman. It's actually in a red hymnal. And about 10 years ago, Mark Hall and Casting Crowns resurrected this song. Here comes my singer. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. Mark Hall and Casting Crowns resurrected this song, and it's a beautiful song about Easter morning. It's called Glorious Day. And I tell you what, I'm going to invite you to stand. This is a good song to stand and sing with us. A beautiful song, Glorious Day.
Stretched out on a tree, and
One day the grave could conceal him no longer. One day the stone rolled away from the door. Then he arose, over death he had conquered. Now he's ascended, my Lord, evermore.
Death could not hold him, the grave could not keep him from rising again. Living he loved me, dying he saved me, buried he carried my sins far away. Rising he justified freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day, glorious day. One day the trumpet will sound for his coming. One day the skies with his glory will shine. Wonderful day, my beloved one bringing, my Savior Jesus is mine. Living he loved me, dying he saved me, buried he carried my sins far away. Rising he justified freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day.
See you.